We've done it, guys. We have covered the Avatar universe before Aang, the events during The Legend of Aang, and the comics picking up after the show ended. Now, we're at the final part of our complete Avatar timeline, The Legend of Korra. So settle down, dear viewers, and grab yourself a cabbage snack, because I'm Chris Carr, and this is The Legend of Korra Timeline Explained. Now, Korra doesn't have a lot of filler, but it does have some filler B-plots. So for the purposes of this timeline, I'll be glossing over a few things like lemur training. You let me know if I missed anything major though, okay? Book 1, Air. We kick things off with Book 1, Air. In our very first episode, we see that young Korra, the next in the cycle of avatars, already has a pretty strong command of some of the other elements when the Order of the White Lotus comes to confirm her.
I'm the Avatar! You gotta deal with it!
After years of training, Korra grows restless of being stuck training within the confines of her tribe. Aang's youngest child, and only child with airbending abilities, Tenzin, was set to be Korra's airbending teacher. Due to political issues in Republic City, however, Tenzin cannot stay and teach Korra at this time. Against the wishes of the Order, Korra leaves home with her trusty polar bear dog, Naga, and travels to Republic City, the new capital of the Unified Four Nations. Once Korra arrives, however, she learns this city isn't the utopian destination she's heard of. The city is struggling with criminal bending gangs, corruption, and a very vocal anti-bending group. It's basically Zootopia. Korra spots a crime unfolding in front of her and decides to dish out some Avatar justice. She stops the criminals and also does some serious damage to the town.
Not to mention evading arrest. You're in a whole mess of trouble, young lady.
But there were some thugs threatening a helpless shopkeeper, and I
had it.
She's taken to the police and meets Chief Lin Beifong, daughter of Toph Beifong. Lin is super unimpressed with Korra being the Avatar. Tenzin, incredibly pissed at Korra, bails her out of jail. Korra is able to convince Tenzin that she should stay at Republic City and train to help restore balance at the capital. We should note that Tenzin married Air Acolyte Pima. Pima fell in love with Tenzin while he was still in a relationship with Lin and kind of broke the two of them up when she professed her love for him. Lin didn't handle this well and actually tried to imprison Pima. Love is bananas. Pima and Tenzin have three children, Jinora, Iki, Milo, and a fourth baby on the way, who Pima really hopes will not be an airbender. Korra seriously struggles with mastering airbending. She's never been able to bend air. Tenzin assures her this is just because of her personality being so different from that of airbenders, and she'll be able to master it, should she stick to a disciplined, quiet training program on the isolated airbender island. To change things up and get a different look at the city, Korra suggests she and Tenzin check out a pro bending match. Tenzin is not down. Korra decides to go against Tenzin's wishes and sneaks out to attend the match at the pro bending arena. There, she runs into brothers Mako and Bolin. Bolin immediately takes a shine to our girl, while Mako is unimpressed and shrugs her off as some pro bending groupie. Like her predecessor, Korra pulls that Avatar card out to put him in his place.
You're the Avatar, and I'm an idiot.
Both are true.
No way.
When the waterbending member of their bending team, the Fire Ferrets, quits, Korra steps up to take his place. The arena allows it, but forbids Korra from using any of her other bending abilities in order to keep things fair. Tenzin realizes that this is a forum that will allow Korra to grow and learn about bending in a way that best suits her personality. Plus, he finds himself getting super amped about these fights. It's adorable. Now, Mako and Bolin aren't the richest of teens. Their parents were killed by a rogue firebender when they were younger, and the two have had to rely on each other ever since. They even live in the pro-bending arena. In order for the Fire Ferrets to remain in the upcoming pro-bending tournament, they'll need to cough up 30,000 yuans to pay all the necessary registration fees. Bolin agrees to take on a gig as extra muscle for one of the local gangs, the Triple Triad Threats. Korra and Mako are really worried about Bolin when they can't find him, and decide to go looking for him. They realize there's gonna be some sort of turf war between all the gangs. Bolin's not shady security job leads to him getting kidnapped by the Equalists. Korra and Mako fight these goons and end up getting chi-blocked by Amon's henchmen. Korra and Mako follow some leads that take them to an anti-bending rally. There, Amon is removing the bending abilities of gang members. Permanently. This is a startling revelation, as only the Avatar has been known to actually bend energy like that. With Bolin's bending in jeopardy, Korra and Mako create a distraction and get him out of there. Korra fills Tenzin in on Amon's abilities and the danger of the revolution. Now we shift gears to have a classic meet-cute. You know, when you almost run someone over, so you go on a date with them, that old chestnut? To be fair, this girl, Asami, is a babe. She takes Mako out for a fancy dinner, complete with getting him a new suit, and offers to introduce him to her father, the man behind Future Industries, Hishira Sato. Sato offers to become the sponsor of the Fire Ferrets, and it looks like our dude's money problems are over. We learn that Asami has also experienced great loss. She lost her mother when she was very young. While all this is going on, Councilman Tarlok keeps trying to win over Korra and have the Avatar join his task force, a group that will help eradicate the Equalists. Tenzin counsels Korra to not take this path, as violence meeting more violence may just exacerbate the rising tension. Tarlok tries to woo Korra over with gifts, and when she refuses, he manipulates a situation in which she has to join him. At a gala, cornered by the press, Korra joins his task force. Ultimately, Korra challenges Amon of the Equalists to a duel on Aang Memorial Island. This, da doy, ends up being a bad move, and Amon sicks his henchmen on Korra.
Though it would be the simplest thing for me to take away your bending right now, I won't. You'd only become a martyr.
He uses the opportunity to go full villain and start monologuing about how he's gonna fight Korra when he decides, and in a way that won't lead to her being a martyr. Korra has a vision of grown-up Toph and Aang before being rescued by Tenzin. So, there's a crazy cult leader who can take away people's bending, but also pro-bending and romance! Bolin likes Korra, Korra likes Mako, Mako likes Asami. These unrequited feelings throw our buds off their bending groove, but the Fire Ferrets somehow pull it together and make it to the pro-bending championship. Oh, also Cabbage Guy gets his due, and apparently Cabbage Corp is one of the most successful companies that exists among the United Republic.
Brought to you by Cabbage Corp, Republic City's trusted name in technology for over 50 years.
With the Equalists getting more bold, there's a possibility of canceling the tournament, since Amon has made blatant threats. Korra and Chief Beifong advise for the tournament to still be held, and the United Republic Council disregards the Equalist threat. This proves to be a horrible mistake, and the arena is attacked. During the attack, Korra is knocked out, and as she's being dragged, she has another Avatar vision of events Aang lived through. Amon gives his mission statement: remove the bending proletariat that is repressing the non-benders of the world. Amon escapes, Lin saves Korra from being an Avatar pancake, and the war for Republic City officially begins. With their home destroyed, Bolin and Mako move to the Sato Estate. The Republic City police are working hard to track down anyone aiding and hiding Amon. And oh sh**, Cabbage Corp is said to be working with the Equalists by making those Tony Stark gloves the henchmen use. Korra, bummed about the boys choosing to live with Asami, goes to her palatial manor and gets to know her. Turns out, this girly-looking girl isn't all about makeovers and shopping. She loves inventing and car races. She's a badass. Korra is actually gonna be able to be friends with this chick. Unfortunately, Korra overhears Mr. Sato scheming and conspiring about the Cabbage Corp cover-up. Korra tells Lin and Tenzin about what she heard, and Tenzin fills Korra in on how he definitely could be motivated to work against benders since his wife was killed by one. You know what's a great way to win over your friends? Turning their parents into the popo. Mr. Sato assures the police that he has nothing to hide and no Equalist ties, and the police are hard-pressed to find any evidence saying otherwise. An informant informs Korra, Tenzin, and Lin that Sato had an underground Equalist workshop beneath his mansion. Lin finds it, thanks to her dope-ass bending abilities. They uncover this sneaky workshop filled with suits made to take on benders. These platinum mecha techs are designed in a way that even a skilled metal bender can't mess with them. All of Sato's pro-bending efforts were merely a cover-up for his Equalist actions and agenda. Sato asks his daughter to join him, but Asami sticks with her bending buddies. Our heroes are able to grab Tenzin and Lin, but unfortunately, a large member of Lin's metal benders are taken by the Equalists. Lin vows to find them and solve this Equalist problem her way, outside the law. She resigns from being police chief. Everyone moves into Air Temple Island, including Asami, and are welcomed warmly. Meanwhile, Lin's replacement is totally up Tarlok's butt. When Korra calls this out, Tarlok doubles down on douchiness and asks her how her airbending is going. Show the Avatar some goddamn respect, you three-ponytailed chode. Korra feels so called out and really doubts herself and her ability to be the Avatar. Tenzin suggests that she work on connecting with her previous selves in order to learn how to airbend. Maybe those hallucinations and dreams she's had are her past lives calling out. Korra's friends reassure her that they're a team, that Avatar Aang didn't have it all figured out when he took on the Fire Lord, and that they're Team Avatar 2.0.
The new Team Avatar!
We got your back, Korra, and we can save the city together.
Yeah, let's do it.
Our team goes out and kicks some Equalist butt that night. Tarlok is pissed that Korra handled these revolutionists without his task force. Tarlok doubles down and wants to punish all non-benders, proposing that being an Equalist is punishable by law, and that all non-benders must follow a strict curfew. Despite Tenzin's protests, the rest of the council seems to side with Tarlok. Tarlok even arrests Korra's friends just to manipulate her. Fed up with Tarlok's BS, Korra goes to speak with him at night. Tarlok attacks Korra when she won't join him and reveals himself to be a bloodbender. He imprisons her so she won't stay in his way or reveal his terrible secret. While captured, Korra meditates on the visions of Aang's life that have been running through her mind. She learns that this is the trial of a well-known mobster and bloodbender, Yakone, who the Avatar energy bent to remove his bending. Meanwhile, Team Avatar, Lin, and Tenzin are searching for Korra. They realize that Tarlok kidnapped Korra and that he's a bloodbender. Instead of going quietly, Tarlok gets to bloodbending everybody and attacks. Korra figures out that Tarlok is Yakone's son, which he fesses up to. As he plans to take Korra with him as a hostage as he starts a new life, Amon shows up at Tarlok's hideout. Tarlok bloodbends all of Amon's henchmen, but his bending doesn't seem to strongly affect Amon. Amon takes Tarlok's ability to bend. Lin, Tenzin, and Team Avatar find those captive metal-bending police benders. Unfortunately, their bending has been removed, but our heroes are able to help them escape. Korra escapes, heading back to Republic City. Mako, paying so much attention to Korra as she recovers, rubs Asami the wrong way, and their relationship begins to fray. More important than teen angst, council members start getting snatched by the Equalists. Only Tenzin remains, and is left in charge of the city. Lin stays at Air Temple Island to protect Tenzin's family. Team Avatar takes on the Equalists, while Lin and the Airbending kids fight him over on the island. Oh, and Pima goes into labor. Jesus, was this a sweeps episode? In order to protect the only airbenders around, Lin and Tenzin decide to relocate Tenzin, Pima, and the kids. More Equalists come to the island, and Team Avatar escapes on Naga, thanks to the help of the White Lotus soldiers. Lin sacrifices herself to stop the airship following Tenzin's family. She metal bends those ships, just like Mommy Dearest did in the OG Avatar series when they were up against the Fire Nation. Unfortunately, she's captured by the enemy, but her air nomads are able to escape. Amon removes Lin's bending when she won't reveal where the Avatar is. Word of what's happening at Republic City makes it to General Iroh, Zuko's grandson, who is still voiced by Dante f***ing Bosco, and he sets a course to go and help the city. The gang has taken refuge in an underground city, and has been doing reconnaissance on Equalist activities while they await the General's fleet. Unfortunately, the fleet is destroyed by Equalist biplanes, and the team has to split up. General Iroh teams up with Bolin and Asami to take out the airfield, while Korra and Mako find Tarlok, who reveals to them that Amon is his brother, Noatok, a northern waterbender and also the son of Yakone. Their father trained them in waterbending and taught the boys how to bloodbend. When Yakone made the boys bloodbend each other and Tarlok refused, Noatok bloodbent their father and ran away from home. Korra plans to reveal Amon as a bender at the next rally and expose him to all of his followers. Amon is prepared for this sort of ambush, though, and reveals his scarred face to the crowd, supporting his story of being attacked by a firebender at a young age. Before Korra and Mako can boogie out of there, Amon reveals that he's removing Tenzin and his children's bending next, ridding the world of airbenders once again. Meanwhile, B-Team, Iroh, Bolin, and Asami are captured by Sato, and Asami's like, "I hate you, Dad," and he's like, "You go to your room, which is a cage now," and plans to destroy Commander Bumi's fleet. Bumi is Tenzin's bro who is on his way to help. Naga busts the B-Team out of jail. Iroh goes after Sato's airplanes, while Asami jumps in a mech to sort out some family feuding. Back at that Equalist rally, Korra goes after Amon in hopes of saving the airbenders. They manage to create a diversion, getting them to safety. However, that leaves Korra and Mako to square off against Amon. Amon blunt bends both of them and removes Korra's bending abilities. However, because Korra has yet to unlock her ability to bend a fourth element, Korra is able to airbend even post Amon bending. Korra uses her airbending to expose Amon's true identity when she kicks him in the river and all his stage makeup and liquid latex burns wash off. He's watering
it! What?
He is a bender!
The scar's fake!
The Avatar was telling the truth!
Noatok tries to leave town with Tarlok on a speedboat, which Tarlok blows up with a Future Industries electrified glove.
It will be just like the good old days.
Master Katara shows up to help try and heal Korra and restore her bending, but is unable to do so. But Korra manages to engage her spiritual side and connect with her previous incarnations, who are able to unlock her bending and gift her with the ability to energy bend and restore the bending abilities of others. Korra and Mako admit their feelings for one another, and they become boyfriend and girlfriend. Book 2, Spirits. Since we last left our heroes, Mako has joined the police force, Bolin is pro-bending with new teammates, Asami is trying to save her family's company, and Bumi has retired from the military. Tenzin is frustrated that Korra still doesn't really get the importance of her spiritual connection, the Avatar state, or that she needs to learn proper airbending technique. Before working on all that, though, everyone is going to go to Korra's hometown to attend the Glacier Spirits Festival, where they'll all be reunited with Katara as well as the other Aang baby, Kaya, a waterbender like her mother. Also in attendance at the festival is the chief of the Northern Water Tribe, Chief Unalaq, and his creepy-ass kids. Unalaq also happens to be Korra's uncle. He reveals to them that angry spirits have been attacking sailors out at sea. Meanwhile, Asami and Bolin go to a meeting with venture capitalist Varric. During that meeting, Varric pitches movers, moving pictures. Varric and Asami come to a business agreement, I guess, and Bolin goes full Tex Avery for an actress. There's still a lot of arguing as to who should be teaching Korra about her spirituality. But after Unalaq manages to subdue an angry spirit, Korra decides he should be her instructor. Tenzin goes to the Southern Air Temples regardless, with his family and siblings in tow. Korra's father, Tonrok, is incredibly upset with Korra working with his brother, and demands he come along with them as they train in the South Pole. Mako Bolin and the Shifty Twins come along as well. Unalaq tells Korra that he plans to have her help him open a portal to the spirit world, and that she'll be working to help restore balance. Korra wonders why dark spirits come after them, and Unalaq says that it's because of her father. Apparently, Tonrok was banished for almost destroying the entire tribe when he destroyed a spiritual forest in order to defeat some invading barbarians. He unknowingly let loose angry spirits who threatened to destroy the entire city. Unalaq was able to guide the spirits back to the forest, but by then, the damage had already been done, and the tribe cast Tonrok out of the Northern Water Tribe. Korra sends her father away after yet another spirit attack, and continues her quest to open the spirit portal. And she does! While all this has been going down, Jinora has been exploring the air temple and comes across a really weird creepy statue. Once all the spirit stuff seems to be taken care of, our team wanders back to the village, where they discover a fleet of northern forces have made their way to the southern shores. After Unalaq stirred the pot about spiritual salvation and spirit attacks at the festival, tensions are flaring between the north and the south. Things get even more complicated when the southerners start prepping for war, and some rebels decide to try and kidnap Unalaq. Obviously, Korra has to step in. This leads to the arrest of the rebels, but also the arrest of Korra's parents. Everyone but Sina, Korra's mother, is released from jail. Everyone else is condemned to life in prison. While working to free her father, Korra learns that Uncle Unalaq actually set up everything.
Then why did he have you free my mother and change your sentence?
He's trying to keep you on his side, but he also wants your father out of the way.
The trial, his brother's banishment, all of it. So obviously, she's not cool having him teach her. With the help of crazy-ass Varric, Team Avatar frees all those jailbirds. Korra pledges to help her father, but he insists that she gain the favor of the president to join the Southerners' cause. During this time, Aang's kids come to terms with how they were raised. Tenzin overlooked his father's shortcomings, and the others had a tendency to dump their frustrations with Dad on him. At the end of the day, they're all a family, and that's what matters. Oh, also, the girl Shining Twin has been sort of dating Bolin. He broke up with her and she's gone full Kathy Bates. Team Avatar, with Zhu Li and Varric in tow, make it back to Republic City, and with no time to spare. There's going to be a protest that evening supporting the Southern Water Tribe. This leads to yet another fight between Korra and Mako. Mako thinks Korra should remain neutral, and Korra is anything but. She's only there to get the president to help her with her people. Unsurprisingly, there's an attack at the protest. Korra calls Northern Water Tribe. Mako tells her he saw a firebender running from the blast. Meanwhile, Bolin is tearing up the town with Varric. Bolin is such a crowd favorite that Varric decides to make Bolin the star of his movers. Korra and Varric go to meet with the president. He's basically Switzerland about this situation. So they'll go around the president. Asami will ship mechs to the south, Korra will chat with her military contacts, and Bolin will make propaganda films! The president hears about this plan from Mako and puts the kibosh on Korra getting Iroh involved. But he suggests she get in touch with his mother, the Fire Lord, and his grandfather, Zuko.
But you should talk to the Fire Lord. My mother and grandfather have always been good friends to the Avatar and the Southern Water Tribe.
Also, Korra is pissed at her boyfriend. They break up, which, also, yay, I was never a fan of these two together. They're better as friends and way too volatile as a couple. Speaking of volatile, Bolin's ex and her brother come after Korra. Before they can get her, though, a dark spirit rises out of the ocean and seemingly snarfs up Korra. Back in Republic City, Asami gets to police headquarters after learning there was an attack on her company's shipment. Mako believes the bombing of the Future Industry ship is linked to the bombing of the Southern Water Tribe Cultural Center. Mako ends up roping in the Triple Threat Triad as manpower for their operation. While aboard the ship, Mako talks to Asami about his breakup with Korra. Mako leaves to check on the gang members and overhears how they've been hired by someone else to keep Asami busy. Mako and Asami escape the ship on a speedboat, rushing back to Future Industries. Unfortunately, they're too late and the entire warehouse has been looted. Mako gives Asami a pep talk, which leads her to impulsively kiss him, and then they get super awkward and go back to cracking this case. Mako visits his brother Bolin on set and realizes that the pyrotechnics the film is utilizing uses remote detonators, just like the ones at the bombings. Mako believes Varric is behind all these attacks and is out to prove it. However, Asami announces that Varric has bought Future Industries' controlling interest, which has saved her company once again. So Mako decides he'll need more dirt on Varric before he can loop his friends in. Remember that Korra was maybe sea spirit food? Well, She washes up on the shore, has no idea who she is, and is found by some tribesmen. So, this means that Korra is going to have to connect to the first avatar, Wan, and learn about the spirits, particularly Rava and Batu. If you watch part one of this timeline, you're up to speed on how that all went down. Wan's story helps Korra see her path to restoring the balance between the physical world and the spirit world. She wakes up and is told by the shaman who's been watching over her that harmonic convergence is upon them. Refresher, if you didn't watch our spirit guides or previous timelines, harmonic convergence is a supernatural occurrence that takes place every 10,000 years, when light and darkness battle for the fate of the world. Korra is reunited with Tenzin and asks him to help her enter the spirit world so she can close the southern spirit portal from within. However, it turns out that Tenzin, Mr. Spiritual, has never been able to enter the spirit world. Jinora proves to be a beacon of spirituality and is able to aid Korra. Tenzin allows Jinora to accompany Korra into the spirit world. While this is going down, Mako and Asami get back together, and Mako continues investigating Varric. After turning down an offer to work for Varric as security, the police come to Mako's place where evidence has been planted to make it look like Mako robbed Asami and planted all those bombs. Meanwhile, Unalaq is working to open the other spirit portal with his kids. Unalaq shows his true colors when one of his kids is hurt, and he couldn't give a crap. Opening the portal is more important than his injured son. When Unalaq can't open this portal himself, Batu lets him know that the Avatar is alive and well within the spirit world. While watching over Korra and Jinora's bodies at the ancient meditation circle, Tenzin tells his siblings how worried he is about his daughter, saying that he'll never forgive himself if anything happens to her. While Kai and Bumi reassure their brother that she'll be fine, we as an audience can guess that something bad is most definitely going to happen to Jinora. In the spirit world, Korra warns Jinora to be wary of dark spirits. The two are separated, which leads Korra to panic. Her energy is bothering the spirits, but she can't chill. She reverts to a 4-year-old version of herself. While panicking, she accidentally hits a baby dragonbird spirit and injures its wing. She apologizes and picks it up as an old man approaches her offering to help. It's Iroh! He takes her to a tea party where he shows her a teapot that Avatar Wan had used to contain Rava before they fused in harmonic convergence. Meanwhile, Jinora manages to wander into Wan Shitong's library. There, she learns that Batu will be able to bust out of his tree jail if both spirit portals are open during harmonic convergence. Jinora goes to warn Korra about this, but Wan Shitong and Unalaq stop her. Turns out that Wan Shitong is siding with Unalaq, thinking he's a true friend of the spirits. Unalaq takes Jinora to go see Batu. Back at the tea party, toddler Korra throws a tantrum about losing Jinora, which causes the world around her to change. Landscape grows dark, spirits turn dark, it's bad juju. Iroh gets Korra to calm down, which allows her to realize that as the bridge between these two worlds, her emotions can alter reality. Iroh suggests she first help this injured dragon bird spirit before tackling any other problems. They get the baby birdie back to its nest, which calms all the agitated spirits down, which in turn returns her to her normal self. Korra makes her way to the southern spirit portal, but is stopped by Batu. Korra ignores Batu's threats at first, but when Batu threatens Jinora, Korra pauses. Unalaq is threatening to destroy Jinora's soul with his jacked up waterbending. Korra is understandably pissed that her uncle has deceived her and is being such a douche and threatening a kid. But Korra is unwilling to sacrifice Jinora and reluctantly opens the portal, allowing Batu's barriers to fall. Right after Korra opens the portal, Unalaq attacks Korra and dark spirits get away with the young airbender. As Unalaq is about to demolish Korra's spirit, the dragonbird spirit that Korra saved swoops on in and kicks the shit out of Unalaq before grabbing the avatar. She's carried off to safety. Batu starts shit-talking to Rava, saying that he'll be free for harmonic convergence and have his revenge. Korra wakes back up in the real world, where an eager Tenzin asks Korra all about it, if the spirit world was cool, before Korra meekly apologizes for Jinora not coming back, leaving Tenzin totally mortified. Tenzin takes Jinora's body back to the air temple, where he must reassure Pima that he'll do whatever it takes to retrieve Jinora's spirit from the spirit world. Later, Mako visits Bolin in prison. Remember, he's been framed for all those bombings. Bolin talks about his mover premiere, and Mako urges his younger brother to keep an eye on Varric since he definitely believes he's a shady dude. Bolin dismisses this warning because he thinks his brother is planning on pleading insanity. At the premiere of The Adventures of Nuk-Tuk, Hero of the South, Varric personally greets the president. The president believes this film is merely propaganda for the South, which, I mean, yeah, and stands by his previous statement of keeping the United Forces out of the Water Tribe Civil War. An overwhelmed Bolin ditches the screening and spots an abandoned boat tied to the arena's dock and decides to investigate. He finds out that a group of waterbenders have infiltrated the building and are after the president. This is an awesome scene where Bolin, fighting these benders, has his actions sync up with what Nuk-Tuk is doing in the mover, and it's so cool! Once subdued, one of the captured benders reveals that they were in fact hired by Varric. Bolin's pithy co-star Ginger finally digs Bolin after seeing him in action. Then, Korra arrives with Tenzin, Bumi, and Kai on Oogie the Air Bison, and Korra informs the president of Unalaq's plan to merge with Batu and destroy the world, pleading with him to finally intervene. the president sticks to his guns, and everyone agrees they should have let those shady waterbenders kidnap him. Now that Barak has proved to be the cad Mako said he was, Mako is freed from prison. He's promoted to detective, and things are looking up for him. But Korra runs up and kisses him. Apparently, she has no memory of them breaking up. Mako goes along with this, which is obviously incredibly annoying to Asami. Balin suggests the group visits Varric to talk Unalaq strategy. They visit him in a lavish cell designed by himself, anticipating his own incarceration. Varric explains that his intention was always just to pull the president and the United Republic into the Water Tribe Civil War. Varric goes on to say that all the stolen Future Industries goodies are stored on his battleship, the Julie, named after his assistant, and gives them the ship as an act of goodwill. Meanwhile, the Southern Water Tribe rebels plan to attack the Northern Army to drive them out of their city. Things go smoothly until Unalaq and his children arrive with a bunch of dark spirits, forcing the rebels to take cover. Tonrot goes after his brother alone, and the two siblings square off.
You are not the true chief.
I am. And you will bow to me.
Unalaq wins and promises his brother that Korra will separate his hands similarly. Family picnics must suck for these guys. Jinora's spiritless body is placed in Katara's care, as Korra and co. work to break through the northern defenses in hopes of reaching the southern spirit portal. Aang's kids split to search for Jinora's spirit, while Mako and Bolin hold back Unalaq in an attempt to give Korra time to close the spirit portal. Unfortunately, harmonic convergence starts before she's able to, and Vatu breaks free from his tree prison, just like Hex is from Ferngully. With Vatu free, Korra works to keep him from merging with Unalaq and forming the Dark Avatar. Korra enters the Avatar state and chucks Unalaq out through the southern spirit portal, and then she sets her sights on Vatu. While this is happening, Tenzin, Kaya, and Bumi continue looking for Jinora in the spirit forest. Tenzin suggests they use a spirit guide, and unfortunately, are guided by a dark spider spirit off a cliff. As they try to regain their bearings, they realize they're totally lost. Meanwhile, Bolin and Mako are keeping an eye out for Unalaq outside the southern spirit portal. They're bombarded by some ice attacks, but remind themselves that all they have to do is keep Unalaq out of the spirit world. Back in the spirit world, Aang's kids run into Iroh, who offers to guide them out of the spirit world. Tenzin is grateful, but lets him know that he simply can't leave without his daughter. Iroh warns them to be cautious, as they could wind up in a place where only the lost will ever find them. Iroh poofs off before he explains anything else. Back with Korra, Vatu has gone a bit hentai and is suspending Korra in the air with evil dark vines. She uses the Avatar state to augment her firebending to escape and is able to imprison him once more in the Tree of Time. While this is going down, Balin and Mako are ambushed by Unalaq's children, allowing Unalaq the opportunity to re-enter the spirit world. Unalaq breaks Korra's hold of Vatu and knocks her down. Desna and Eska drag an unconscious Bolin and Mako away from the portal, but our bending bros wake up and surprise the twins, springing through the portal. Korra uses the last of her power to fireblast Uncle Unalaq, but it's no use. Unalaq fuses with Vatu.
I will lead them all as the new Avatar.
Well, I'm the old Avatar, and my era's not over yet.
Tenzin decides to piss off that dark spider spirit again in order to get to the prison he believes Jinora is being held in. The spider takes them to the Fog of Lost Souls, a fog spirit that can infect the minds of humans and imprison them in their darkest memories, causing them to go insane. You'll notice that pain in the ass Zhao is wandering around there, muttering how he'll get the Avatar and that he's the Moonslayer. When he sees Tenzin, he tries to attack him, thinking he's Aang. Kai and Bumi separate them, and Zhao is lost to the fog once more. Tenzin uses his sash as a rope to tie Kaya and Bumi to himself so they can stay together, but Bumi and Kaya succumb to the effects of the fog, panic, and untie themselves. Tenzin attempts to lift the fog with airbending, but he fails. He begins to have his own nightmares, his fears of failing his father's legacy. However, Aang appears to him and tells him that he's his own person, and he shouldn't try to be like him. Finding himself for the first time, Tenzin is able to find Jinora and his siblings and escape the fog. Meanwhile, Unalaq, now the Dark Avatar, and Korra move their fight to the physical world. It looks like Unalaq and Vatu are going to win when Rava reaches out to Korra, reminding her that she's the Avatar and cannot allow darkness to win. Back in the Avatar state, Korra gets fired up again. Trapped in the Tree of Time, Mako begs Desna and Eska to release him and his brother. Bolin tries a different tactic, sobbing over the fact that he'll never be able to be with Eska again if the world ends. Moved by this, Eska kisses Bolin and releases the brothers. As they pop back into the physical world, they watch Korra and Unalaq battle each other in their respective avatar states. Vatu leaves Unalaq's body and rips Rava from Korra's. Before Vatu can re-enter Unalaq, Korra traps the dark spirit in a shell of ice. This victory is short-lived as Unalaq attacks Rava. With each blow, Korra's connection to her past lives splinters even more. Eventually, Unalaq destroys Rava's physical form. This disturbance triggers Jinora, who rushes to help. the Dark Avatar proclaims the beginnings of 10,000 years of darkness and enters Republic City. As Unalaq is out rampaging through Republic City, Varric is exercising his fancy jail cell, listening to radio coverage of the attack. As Spirit Vines bust through the walls of his cell, he tells Julie to commence Operation Winged Freedom, and he pops out on a glider. He and Julie do the thing and glide out of there. Elsewhere, Tenzin, Kaya, and Bumi find Korra, Mako, and Bolin, all of who are knocked out, and carry them back into the spirit world, where Kaya heals our trio in a pool of spirit water. When they come to, Korra tells everyone that Unalaq destroyed Rava, and she has zero connection to her previous lives, effectively making her the last avatar. Tenzin, fresh with knowledge from Daddy Aang, tells Korra that just as he is more than the son of Aang, she is more than the counterpart of Rava. She has power. They take off to the Tree of Time. Inside the tree, Tenzin explains that before it was a prison for Vatu, it was used by ancient folks to connect with cosmic energy. As the tree remembers all, it should help her find her inner spirit. Korra meditates, and energy bends her spirit out of her body to form a giant woman astral projection of herself, and transports herself to Republic City. There, Unalaq Vatu Dark Avatar, first of his name, father of Shifty Twins, is still tearing stuff up. Then, Korra's spirit attacks. Back in the spirit world, dark spirits are going after Korra's defenseless body. So, Team Avatar 2.0 has to fight them off, with the help of Desna and Eska, who have had a change in allegiances. Unavatu begins to corrupt Korra's spirit with spirit bending. Just as it seems all hope is lost, a bright light falls from the sky, stopping the Dark Avatar momentarily. That light is Jinora's spiritual projection. She helps free Korra's spirit and brings Rava back. Spirit Korra beats the crap out of Unalaq and rips the light spirit from him, and spirit bends Unavatu. The Dark Avatar is defeated, and Korra and Rava merge once more. Jinora returns to her physical body. Eska and Desna decide to return home to the Water Tribe. Korra asks Tenzin if he agrees with Unalaq that humans and spirits should live together, and he says he has faith in her to make that decision herself. Korra tells Mako that the Tree of Time brought back all of her memories, including her fight with him, and Mako and Korra agree that a romantic relationship will never work between them, despite them loving one another. The Water Tribe Civil War comes to an end, Tonrok is the tribe's new chief, and Korra leaves both spirit portals open for spirits and humans to live in harmony. She denounces the Avatar status as the bridge between spirits and humans, but vows to continue to use Rava's spirit to bring balance and peace to the world. We're left with a very new Avatar world, one shared with spirits. Book 3, Change. Book 3 takes place 2 weeks after Team Avatar took down Unavatu, and spirits began roaming freely in the physical world. Korra is trying to tame the spirit vines that have grown all over Republic City, her relationship with the president begins to strain, and her approval rating with the people of the city has plummeted. Asami assures her that she'll turn things around. While this is happening, people began manifesting airbending powers, including Bumi. Tenzin is thrilled at the possibility of rebuilding the Air Nation, and Korra offers to join him for searching for new airbenders. Well, she sort of has to. She's been banished from the city by the president after he blames her for all the spirit chaos and uncontrolled airbending. But hey, new mission. Meanwhile, Zaheer, a prisoner of the White Lotus, is also granted airbending abilities and overwhelms his guards with his new bending abilities. Zaheer is the leader of a group known as the Red Lotus. Avatar anarchists, basically, who believe that the world should not have the White Lotus, the Avatar, or Harmonic Convergence. He also tried to murder Korra as a kid, hence him being in prison. Hello, season big bad. So, Team Avatar, Tenzin, and Jinora make way to the Earth Kingdom to recruit new airbenders to form a new air nation. But no one's really chomping at the bit to leave their lives and worldly possessions behind. They are able to have a young guy named Kai join them, who Jinora definitely digs. Kai is the bad boy of Tenzin's nightmares. Back to Zaheer, he goes off and frees some of his buds from their prisons. While Lord Zuko learns of their escape, he sets a course for the Northern Water Tribe to stop them from freeing the last member of the Red Lotus, Zaheer's girlfriend. Next, Team Avatar heads to good old Ba Sing Se, where Korra has an audience with the Queen. The Queen agrees to help Korra find airbenders within the city only if she first collects tax money from a small village nearby. The tax collection gig seems shady at best. Troublemaker Kai is missing, so Bolin and Mako go in search of him. While they go looking for him, they run into their father's relatives and learn that they have a huge family living in the Earth Kingdom. Korra comes to the Queen with the tax money and asks her about the airbenders of Ba Sing Se. The Earth Queen lies through her teeth and says that the Dai Li haven't found a single airbender. Korra and the crew should leave the city whenever they're ready. Korra doesn't believe the Queen and states that she'll stick around until she finds those airbenders. Back with Bolin and Mako's relatives, the boys let their family know that they must return to the Upper Ring to help Korra find airbenders. Their family clues them in to how the Dai Li have been capturing airbenders for the Earth Queen. The boys let Korra know and go back to looking for Kai. All this time, Kai's been busy robbing folks. The Dai Li catch him and throw him in an underground cell containing other airbenders, where he's informed that he's now a member of the Earth Kingdom Army. Meanwhile, Lord Zuko, Chief Tonrok, Desna, and Eska face off against Zaheer and his crew as they attempt to save his Lady Hylee.
I've waited 13 years to feel this warm.
Back in the Earth Kingdom, Team Avatar works to free the Airbenders. Despite Zaheer being out and threatening Korra's life, Korra refuses to leave Ba Sing Se without helping the imprisoned Airbenders. They bust everyone out and send them off to the Northern Air Temple, and continue their search throughout the Earth Kingdom for more Airbenders. Their travels take them to the home of the Metal Clan, a commune run by Suyin Beifong, Lin's half-sister. The two have a strained relationship and haven't been in touch for years. Suyin's daughter, Opal, is the Airbender they've come to collect. Opal and Bolin vibe with one another, but only when he's trying not too hard to impress her.
Wow, you're really blowing me away with your airbending.
Over at the Air Temple, Zaheer shows up, going by the name Yaru, and claims to seek refuge and learn to control his newfound airbending powers. He proves to have a very strong mastery of this bending, though, which surprises Kaya. Later, Zaheer rummages through Tenzin's office. Iki catches him, followed by Kaya. Kaya sends Iki to bed, and Kaya questions Zaheer on his in-depth knowledge of Air Nomad culture before realizing that he's Zaheer. The two fight, and Zaheer escapes. Back with the Metal Clan, we learn that Varric has gone into business with Suyin, and he's heading up her tech division. Suyin doesn't believe a mistake should define a person, but he blew up stuff and conspired to kidnap the president, so maybe? Korra works to learn metal bending under the tutelage of Suyin. Opal struggles with leaving home, and Bolin deals with the fear of metal bending. While all this is going on, Lin gets acupuncture and deals with her past with Sue and her mother. With a new perspective on her life, Lin is able to convince her niece Opal to travel to the Northern Air Temple to train with Tenzin. Meanwhile, Zaheer and crew deduce that Korra's with the Metal Clan. Back at the Air Temple, Tenzin works to teach all the new recruits how to control their powers. He struggles with being a leader and seeks advice from his brother Bumi. Tenzin says that Bumi was a lot like their father, and Bumi confides in him that he worries about not being a true airbender. During all of this, Jinora had called out her father for not viewing her as an airbending master despite her skill in spirituality. Tenzin concedes that Jinora should be able to get her airbending tattoos soon. Oh, and there were some baby air bisons that were stolen, but the new recruits rescued them and the air bisons accepted them and viewed them as original airbenders, so that's cute. Back with the Metal Clan, Opal gets ready to leave for the Northern Air Temple just as Zaheer and his goons infiltrate the city and try to kidnap Korra. Team Avatar leaves and tries to track down the Red Lotus and put an end to their antics. They learn that the Metal Clan's Truthseer is who corroborated with the Red Lotus, and they pursue him. Korra and Asami track down the Truthseer and realize he's in the spirit world. Korra goes in after him and finds he's chatting with Zaheer, who's chastising him for the botched kidnapping attempt. In this episode, Zaheer reveals to Korra about how he tried to kill her as a child. While they're talking in the spirit realm, her physical body is captured, along with Asami, and is to be transported to the Earth Queen. En route to Ba Sing Se, Korra and Asami escape their cell, but they ultimately lead to the airship they're traveling in to crash into the Siwang Desert. Asami is able to make a sand sailor and get Korra and the four-man crew out of there. Back in Ba Sing Se, Mako and Bolin are imprisoned while the Red Lotus works to make a deal with the Earth Queen. However, Zaheer ends up just killing her using one of the most terrifying bits of airbending we've ever seen in the series. He releases Mako and Bolin, telling them to deliver a message to Korra that the Red Lotus is traveling to the Northern Air Temple and plans to kill all the new airbenders, unless Korra turns herself over to them. As a result of the Earth Queen's death, Ba Sing Se is in chaos. It's Beirut in the 90s, or LA in the 90s. It's any place in the 90s. Team Avatar goes back to visit their buds, the Metal Clan, to see their radio transmitter and contact Tenzin to warn him of this potential attack. This warning comes a little too late, though, as Zaheer has already arrived at the temple and has captured everyone, except Kai. Tenzin stands his ground in this episode and will not back down from Zaheer, even though he's getting pummeled.
As long as I'm breathing, it's not over.
Zuko and Korra finally get to meet, and Zuko offers Korra counsel on what she should do. Zuko reminds her that Aang's greatest wish was to rebuild his nation, but he always understood how much the world needed the Avatar. Korra chooses to turn herself over to the Red Lotus in order to save the Airbenders. Rookie mistake, Zaheer obviously double-crosses her. Bolin, trying to help save everyone, learns that he can lava bend, which is insane! We also see that Zaheer is capable of levitating. Big powers day for a lot of folks. Sadly, while talking to Zaheer, Korra's father is thrown off a cliff. We also see the end of Zaheer's girlfriend, Pylee, who was battling the Beifong sisters. Korra is captured, and Zaheer assures her that her suffering will end soon, as he presents her with a bowl of metallic poison. Zaheer explains that once he poisons Korra, her body will be forced to enter the Avatar state in order to keep her alive. When she does, he plans to kill her and permanently break the Avatar cycle. Killing the Avatar will bring about a new era of true freedom. Jinora's astral projection watches nearby and eavesdrops on Zaheer's plane. Using metal bending, the earthbending Red Lotus applies the metallic poison to Korra's arms and legs and infuses the poison into Korra's body. Korra fights off entering the Avatar state. As the poison spreads, the Avatar begins to see visions of her past foes, Amon, Unalaq, and Batu. Back where the airbenders are being held captive, they plead for water. Guards start to hand them some as Jinora blasts the guards, causing his keys to fly off. Milu then bends them to opal. Then Lin and the rest of the rescue party pops up to take down the Red Lotus guards. They decide to get the injured benders out of there. Tonrok, who isn't dead, goes looking for Korra with Bolin and Mako. Jinora lets them know just where to find her. Korra finally succumbs to the poison and releases the full Avatar state. The Red Lotus definitely underestimated the power of the Avatar though, and is having a really hard time murdering her. Korra has the upper hand until the poison inside her causes her body to seize and she falls to the ground. While trying to coordinate a plan of attack, Bumi asks Tenzin how Zaheer can fly. Tenzin says that Zaheer has managed to unlock an airbending technique that hasn't been seen for thousands of years. Jinora responds by saying it's been so long since a large number of airbenders have been in the same place, so together they could become more powerful. They join hands and create a tornado which grows as more airbenders join in. Zaheer uses that creepy suffocating move on Korra, but is dragged by the airbender's tornado. As he attempts to escape the vortex, Korra gathers the last of her strength and pulls Zaheer down with the platinum chains that still hang from her limbs, slamming him into the ground. She collapses as Lin and Suyin bind Zaheer in rock prison. Suyin and Lin are able to metal bend the poison out of Korra. 2 weeks after the defeat of Zaheer, everyone comes together at Air Temple Island for Jinora's airbending mastery celebration. The poisoning and fight have left Korra wheelchair bound and depressed. Asami is helping her get ready and reminds Korra that she'll heal in time and that she'll be there whenever she needs her. Tenzin begins the ceremony, marking it as a historic occasion, and unveils his freshly tattooed daughter, who looks so much like Aang that it hurts. Book 4, Balance. Book 4 is set 3 years after the defeat of the Red Lotus. Since then, humans have learned to live harmoniously with spirits. Suyin's son, Batar Jr., and Kuvira, an expert metalbender and captain of the Metal Clan Guard, have been traveling the Earth Kingdom in hopes of reuniting the Severed Nation under her militaristic rule while Prince Wu is being groomed to assume the vacant throne. Mako is working as the prince's bodyguard, and the air nomads have assisted in peaceful negotiations as needed. Asami Sato has helped further modernize Republic City. Bolin is working with Kuvira, much to his girlfriend Opal's chagrin. She fears that Bolin is changing and growing from her, and that this long-distance relationship just won't work. Kai and Jinora are also officially a couple. Kuvira handles things with an iron fist. Rumors of her ruthlessness have spread throughout the nation. As she places towns under her protection, she also makes their leaders swear their allegiance to her. Her protection feels incredibly mob bossy. Elsewhere, our girl Korra is decked out in Earth Kingdom attire and working a bob. She's been participating in paid earthbending matches and hiding her avatar identity. We learn that Korra's been on her own for a while now. 3 years ago, she returned home to the Southern Water Tribe to try and heal her body with Katara's help. While she was able to physically recover after 2 years of waterbending PT, she continued to have PTSD. Visions of Zaheer attempting to take her life plagued her mind. She set out on a journey to connect with Rava by traveling the world, but made no such connection. She ends up in the foggy swamp, passes out, and wakes up in the home of Toph Mother Effin Beifong. We should note that throughout her journeys, Korra kept up a correspondence with Asami. The time with Toph in the foggy swamp is basically like when Luke visits Yoda on Dagobah. Korra asks Toph to get her back into Avatar shape, but she currently feels unfit to serve the world. It turns out that Korra still has some metal inside her body, but Toph ends up telling Korra to get it out herself, as she seems so adamant about keeping it inside her. Tensions flare between Mako and Bolin once they're reunited, as both fight over who is best fit to rule the Earth Kingdom. Kuvira or Wu is planned. Although Wu is anointed as king, Wu does not have the respect of his people, and Kuvira plans to maintain her control. Tenzin tasks his kids Jinora, Iki, and Milo with finding Korra and bringing her back to Republic City, as he must stay behind to deal with the Kuvira situation. Jinora is in charge of this expedition and has had difficulty locating Korra's spiritual energy to track her, leading her siblings to get really annoyed with the lack of progress. The kids learn that Korra was in town 6 months ago, so at least they have a lead. Back to Toph and Korra, Toph is in full tough love teaching mode and is being a bully to Korra, just like she was to Aang. No soft touch here. Milo decides to throw out their food, Jinora won't stop meditating, so Iki takes off annoyed. Aki ends up getting captured by some of Kuvira's guards, who believe she's been sent to spy on them. The guards realize that bringing Tenzin's three children to Kuvira could put them in her good graces. But Aki isn't exactly complying with finding her siblings. Meanwhile, Korra is wandering the forest for food when she has another debilitating vision of her past foes. Milu and Jinora realize that Aki has run off, and they go in search of her. Aki gets the soldiers to open up with her and confides to them that her siblings leave her out of tons of things. One soldier decides to help her by showing her a map and going through it to narrow down where Korra could be. Aki asks if anyone has checked out the foggy swamp, but the idea is dismissed. But Aki is still supported. It's like a reverse Stockholm sitch with her captors. As they offer to untie Aki, Milu charges in and attacks the guard. Aki, sweet, apologizes for her siblings knocking them out and leaves them snacks. Aki then suggests they head to the foggy swamp to look for Korra. Toph explains to the Avatar that she's having these visions because she needs to get better and balanced. Toph decides to take Korra to the Banyan Grove tree to illustrate how Korra must reconnect with herself and her loved ones. She's able to call out to the airbending kiddos, and the four are reunited. The kids tell Korra that she must come home since Kuvira has taken control over the kingdom. Korra pulls the remaining poisoning out of her body and is able to connect to the Avatar state once again. Kuvira marches her army to Zaofu, the home of the Metal Clan, to make Suyin surrender the city to the Earth Empire, but without using force. Just strongly suggesting it. Korra believes that Kuvira can be reasoned with and intends to have a calm chat with her.
Let me talk with Kuvira. Maybe I can reason with her.
Kuvira doesn't listen to reason.
Meanwhile, Varric is experimenting on spirit vines for Kuvira. He doesn't think he should continue working on the vines, but Kuvira forces him to continue experimenting, threatening to kill him if he doesn't continue weaponizing spirit energy. Elsewhere, Asami visits her father in prison. She returns all the letters he sent her and tells him to never contact her and that she never wants to see him ever again. Before she leaves, Sato tells his daughter that he understands and that she's the greatest thing he's ever created. Asami returns later, trying to mend her relationship with her father. Bolin is brought in by Kuvira to win over the Beifongs, who definitely aren't buying what she's selling, and try to set Bolin straight. Bolin begins to question Kuvira's methods. Korra and Suyin discuss how Kuvira came to power. Originally, Tenzin and the president had asked Suyin to be the one to unite the Earth Kingdom and to fill the vacuum of power. Kuvira encouraged her to do so, and when Suyin refused, Kuvira took it upon herself to do this. Korra finally speaks with Kuvira and asks her to back down and remove her army from Zaofu. Kuvira refuses. Bolin ultimately decides to turn against her, joining up with Varric and Julie in an attempt to escape.
Kuvira's crazy!
They're thwarted, however, by Batar Jr. Julie decides to pledge her allegiance to Kuvira, since all she was guilty of was listening to the wrong person, Varric. She says after years of being mistreated, she realized she must turn against him. Suyin tries to take out Kuvira that night, but fails, and she and her twin sons are taken prisoner. Kuvira announces to the people of Zaofu what Suyin has done, and demands the other leaders step forward and pledge their allegiance or suffer the consequences. Kuvira readies her army to invade the Metal City when Korra and Kuvira have a brief standoff. Kuvira proposes they have a one-on-one duel, where Kuvira seems to have the advantage until Korra enters the Avatar state. However, Korra is still having visions and is unable to finish battling. Before Kuvira can land a final blow, Opal and Jinora get the Avatar out of there and flee Zaofu. Suyin's husband Batar and her son Huan will not bow down to Kuvira and are arrested. Meanwhile, Bolin and Varric are forced to continue weaponizing the spirit vine energy. Varric secretly turns the experiment into a bomb, blowing up his research and allowing him and Bolin to escape. Unfortunately, Batar Jr. has closely observed Varric's work and is confident he can continue the project with the help of Julie. The airbending kids and Opal bring Korra back to Republic City and they're reunited with Tenzin. She fills him in on what happened with the Metal Clan and Zaofu, and sees Asami and Mako for the first time in 3 years. Things get a little awkward when Korra tells Mako that she's been writing to Asami while she's been away.
I asked her not to tell you. I'm sorry.
Why didn't you ever write to me? Or Bolin?
I don't know. I guess I didn't know what to say.
Hello would have been nice.
She just didn't know what to say to the others, and talking to Asami felt easier. Catching up is cut short, though, when Prince Wu is kidnapped by the supporters of Kuvira. The team tracks him to Central City Station and rescues him, taking him back to Asami's place to stay with Mako under careful watch. Bolin and Varric join up with a group of fugitive waterbenders and firebenders to cross the Earth Empire border. They evade arrest, reach the shore, and are given a ride in return for their help. Over in the foggy swamp, Kuvira's army starts harvesting spirit vines from the Banyan Grove tree. harvesting spirit vines makes the spirits mighty angry, and they start capturing folks. Janora senses a shift in energy, and Cora and Opal join her to investigate. They learn of how Kuvira is harvesting the vines. Cora and Opal inform the president about this, while Janora continues looking for those that the spirit vines took. The United leaders are discussing the best course of action with Kuvira when Cora and Opal arrive, followed shortly by Varric and Bolin. They fill everyone in on the spirit's super weapon. Tenzin still does not want to include his airbenders in this act of violence, nor does Fire Lord Izumi. This leads Lin to tell Opal that they're going to have to go together on an unsanctioned mission to save the rest of the Beifong family. Bolin apologizes for being fooled by Kuvira, and Cora opens up to the brothers about how she's worried about losing the support of people after being beaten up by Kuvira. Mako gives them all a classic Team Avatar pep talk. Later, Janora is also captured by the spirit vines and sends word to Cora via astral projection. In order to save her, Cora and Mako go to the spirit wilds. The vines were open, so Cora opts to meditate into the spirit world. Once again, visions of Zaheer keep her from entering. She chooses to face Zaheer in person to get over her fear of him and unblock her spiritual mind. Zaheer is against Kuvira taking power, as it is not what he intended for the world, and chooses to help Cora and guide her into the spirit world. Once there, she's able to reconnect with Rava and successfully save Janora and all the other folks who were captured by the spirits. Meanwhile, Asami and Varric are tasked with working to create a defense plan against Kuvira's super weapon, and Bolin tries to win Opal back. But Steve Buns ain't gonna fix this relationship. He ends up going on her and Lin's secret mission to rescue their family. So Opalin and Bolin make their way to Zafu. There, they find Toph, who tells them that their family has been moved from the city. Bolin, with his insider info, knows where they're being kept, and they're able to go rescue them. In Republic City, the president is upset that Asami and Varric won't create spirit vine weapons, and that Cora won't gather the vines. But the Avatar says that she will try to talk the spirits into defending their city. In the spirit world, Cora fails to convince the spirits to join the human war. Back at Zafu, Zhu Li and Batar Jr. are working on that spirit energy cannon, but good old Zhu Li has been working to sabotage the project the whole time! Toph points out that Zhu Li is lying when she pledges how she's working hard on the machine. Zhu Li messes with the weapon, hoping to blow the cannon up, but Kuvira catches on. Bolin and Opal are able to save Zhu Li as the Beifongs fight Kuvira's army. Opal forgives Bolin, and Zhu Li warns them all of Kuvira's plans for Republic City.
Kuvira is going to attack in 2 weeks.
Bolin, the Beifongs, and Zhu Li make it back to Republic City and fill the president and everyone else in on Kuvira's plan. They begin evacuating the city and preparing for Kuvira's attack. Zhu Li attempts to mend the fence with Varric, but is incredibly annoyed when he still treats her like just some meager assistant. Team Avatar goes after Kuvira's spirit energy cannon and learns that it's been attached to a ginormous mecha suit controlled by Kuvira. The team barely escapes and flees back to Republic City to clue everyone in on this huge threat, but Kuvira arrives shortly after. The president, daunted by how powerful this weapon is, surrenders to Kuvira. As Batar Jr. makes his way to discuss the terms of surrender, Cora and Tenzin's family kidnap him and try to learn how to defeat the superweapon. Cora threatens to never let Batar Jr. see his fiancé Kuvira ever again, which causes him to crack. He asks Kuvira over the radio to leave the United Republic alone. Kuvira agrees verbally, but uses the radio signal to trace where Team Avatar is and fires her super cannon at their location, demolishing the facility. So, to be clear, Kuvira is totally cool with murdering her fiancé for her cause. Luckily, Team Avatar gets out of the Future Industries factory relatively unscathed and works to take down Kuvira and that massive Gundam she brought to town. The benders work to slow down the suit, but just aren't powerful enough. Varric tries using electromagnetic pulses to shut the suit down, but is only taking out smaller machines. Hiroshi Sato is temporarily released from prison to help Asami, Varric, and Zhu Li with their hummingbird suits to battle Kuvira's forces. Asami and her father are able to make amends, and Varric proposes to Zhu Li. With their own mech suits converted, Hiroshi is able to make it through the giant mecha, but sacrifices himself in the process. The benders make their way into the opening. Cora, Mako, Bolin, Lin, and Su decide to split up within the mecha, with Cora heading straight for Kuvira. Mako and Bolin work on the weapon's core, while the Beifong sisters try to dismantle the cannon. They destroy its loading mechanism. Kuvira rips off the arm with the cannon on it, with the women still inside, and tosses them into the spirit wilds. Cora arrives in the cockpit to fight Kuvira. Mako and Bolin make their way to the core. Mako nearly dies trying to take it out with his lightning, but Bolin is able to rescue his brother in time. With the core unstable, the suit explodes, blasting the cockpit, and consequently Cora and Kuvira into the spirit wilds as well. Kuvira makes a mad dash for her spirit cannon and blasts it, but she loses control. Cora energy bends the beam to save the two of them, tearing open a new spirit portal and warping the two of them into the spirit world. Cora is finally able to convince Kuvira that she needs to stop fighting. They leave the spirit world, and Kuvira tells her troops to stand down. She's arrested by Sue and Lin. And everyone hugs, because this is Avatar. Sometime later, Varric and Julie get hitched at the Air Temple Island with Bolin as their officiant. Prince Wu reveals that he plans to do away with the Earth Kingdom's monarchy. Korra and Mako cement their friendship, and Korra and Tenzin talk about how much Korra has grown.
You've transformed the world more in a few years than most avatars did during their lifetimes.
Korra and Asami talk about how deeply they care for one another, and Asami suggests they take a spirit world vacation. Korra and Asami walk into the newly created spirit portal, holding hands, thus causing the internet to begin crying out, "Korrasami!" The series may have ended, but the shipping wars had definitely just begun. We made it, guys! 4-part timeline complete! But the world of Avatar is vast and chock full of details, so please let me know if I missed anything, or if you wish I expanded on a favorite event or moment. Should I have gone into lemur training? Probably. Let's keep the Avatar discussion going down in the comments. For more timelines, crash courses, lore, and more, click to the left of my face, or you can watch us on Roku or Plex. Thank you again to Cameron and to all of our sponsors on Patreon, and thank you for watching. I'll see you, Space Cowboy.